We'll be looking at those issues a little bit later, but first we'll take a trip on a transport trail. This week, the US Studies Centre has been looking at the city of the future in a conference in Brisbane. Among the speakers, the president of the US Congress for New Urbanism, John Norquist, who said population growth means high-density living will be the future in cities like Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane. Another speaker at the conference was the Assistant Secretary of Transport for the Obama administration, Polly Trottenberg, one of the president's key advisers. Polly Trottenberg is a guest in Australia of the US Studies Centre at Sydney University, and she joins us now. Polly Trottenberg, thanks very much for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Helen.
Now, it's really interesting because President Obama obviously took a pretty big hit in the midterm elections. What happens now for the US, and what happens to his agenda?
Well, it is true. The president himself said we took a shellacking. And I think we interpret that the message we got from the voters is we really need to focus on the economy and job creation. And I think luckily that's an area where there's going to be some interest in working together in a bipartisan way. And from the point of view of the Department of Transportation, good news is transportation is one of the issues in infrastructure investment that's probably going to be front and center in the coming 2 years. In the U.S., that's been an area of traditional bipartisan cooperation, and there's a real feeling in the country right now that infrastructure is one of the areas we should be investing in.
Well, certainly transport is always of interest to the electorate, whether it be national or state or local. So within the Federal Department of Transport, what are the goals now, and what's possible with this Congress?
Yeah, that's a good question. We in the U.S., we have a big surface transportation bill that we pass every 6 or 7 years that handles highway and transit policy. We're putting together our big proposal. One of our centerpieces is going to be building a high-speed rail system for the whole country. We're also looking at increasing investments across the board. Like Australia, we're very much looking at the question of how we have a transport system which is more environmentally sustainable and less energy intensive.
The big plans for the high-speed rail, I mean, that's a very exciting program, I presume. You've got the $10 billion funding already in place for it. It now seems perhaps that might be in doubt because some states are questioning it, they're balking at the financial stricture that will be produced on them. Will it get through? Will it go ahead? And I believe you've started some parts of it. What progress is there?
Yeah, that's a very good question. We, with the $10.5 billion that we've gotten over the past 2 years, we've started to make investments in 13 corridors around the U.S. Probably our biggest signature areas, California, Florida, the Midwest, cities around Chicago and the cities around Chicago, and then some in the Northeast. It is true, though, with transportation and in a lot of other areas, we have a new crop of governors coming in. They're facing very difficult fiscal situations in their states, and a lot of them are saying we need to take a careful look at what we can afford. I mean, there's no question we're also going to be doing that at the federal level.
So, sorry, the $10 billion won't cover it all, and the states have to put in, do they? So those governors have a real say in this?
Correct, right. The vision in the U.S. is that the federal government and the states are partners, and that the federal government puts in an investment, the states put in an investment, hopefully also there's some private investment. That's the model that California is looking at. I mean, I think, like Australia, in the long run, the U.S. is a country that's going to grow. We're expecting to add 100 million people, in the next 30 years. And, right now we're facing, tough times fiscally, but we also need to have a vision for all the growth that we're going to have in our country. And I think from the Obama administration's point of view, high-speed rail speaks to the growth and future economic prosperity of the country.
Given the population of America and the massive growth that it's already seen in the last several decades, it's kind of amazing that there isn't already a high-speed network like that has been so successful in Europe and parts of Asia too.
Yeah, I mean, I think one thing particularly so different than the European and Asian models, we're more like Australia. We have a very decentralized governmental system. In Europe, I was recently in London as they were getting ready to put their high-speed 2 proposal together. And there, the central government just sort of announced, we're going to do this, we're going to fund most of it, we're going to work with the regions of the country. But it really comes from London. In the U.S., we have a much more decentralized approach, and admittedly, it's been a much slower for us to sort of get that off the ground.
The high-speed rail is talked about here from time to time, and certainly it came up in our recent election campaign. The Greens were pushing for a feasibility study to be done, particularly on our sort of population and busy business corridor of Melbourne, Sydney, Brisbane. Can you see that there might be a good case here for high-speed rail?
I don't want to come in and tell another country what they should do. Obviously, we're working our way through it in the U.S., but high-speed rail works very well in areas where you have population density, where you have a lot of economic activity, where you have growth, where you have distances of sort of 200 to 500 miles between urban centers, and that clearly describes this part of Australia. But, you know, again, a country has to take a long look at all its transportation alternatives, what kind of money it's willing to invest. You know, there are a lot of questions you have to answer before you go forward.
Yeah, and it's interesting, there are a lot of similar things, even though there's a lot different about our countries geographically and population-wise. But some of the similar things, the issues, the challenges that we have to face, do you think part of them in both our countries may be perhaps too much urban and suburban sprawl and maybe too much reliance on the auto?
Yeah, I mean, in the U.S., you know, we built a fantastic interstate highway system, and it brought us a lot of benefits. It brought us tremendous economic growth. You know, it brought us unprecedented personal mobility, gave people a lot of choices about where to live. And, you know, a lot of people, just like in Australia, they moved further and further out. But now we're grappling, I think, as you are too, with there are some costs to that, particularly in the U.S. We have an incredibly energy-intensive transportation system. We use something like 16% of the world's oil for our transportation system. And it's very, very costly. Car ownership in the U.S., it's about $7,000-$8,000 to own a car. And a lot of American families now own two or three, which I think is starting to happen in Australia. So there's some real trade-offs there. And I think we're trying to step back a little bit and say, as much benefits as our highway system has given us, you know, particularly now in a universe where we're more concerned about climate, more concerned about energy independence, we need to put some more alternatives on the table in terms of transportation.
Yeah, so how in a country like Australia, given you're grappling with this issue too, do you balance that tension between building more highways and building better public transport, mass transit?
Yeah, I mean, in the U.S., again, because we're sort of a decentralized model, a lot of the desire, particularly for mass transit, for streetcars, for more walking and biking, what we would call active transportation, is bubbling up at the local level. And, you know, our feeling at USDOT is we want to nurture and support that where it's happening. It's not going to work in the U.S. context to be top-down about it. I have a feeling it sounds like it's sort of the same in Australia.
That's true. There are a lot of push from the bottom up to go bicycles, to go more walking, that sort of thing. So do you think the answer is really you've got to have a whole lot of alternatives?
Absolutely. I mean, in the U.S., you know, we like to say one of our primary missions at DOT is providing people with transportation choices. It's you may want to keep your automobile, but maybe you don't want to use it every day. You don't want to use it to go to work. You want to have the opportunity to use mass transit. You also, I mean, in the U.S., the way we put a lot of our cities together and our suburban sprawl, we've made it very, very hard for people to walk and bike. And one of the ways that's really affected our society, we have an explosion in childhood obesity, which I know in Australia you're also starting to grapple with. 40 years ago, something like 60% of American children walked or biked to school. Now it's about 14%.
How do you wean yourself off the auto as much as Australia as well, but America is really the home of the automobile?
Yeah, what's interesting is we've had a little bit of a natural weaning that's occurred. We had a gas price spike a couple years ago, and people started just changing. Once in the U.S., once gasoline got up to $5 a gallon, I'm like, I don't know what the translation is into liters, people started taking the bus.
Yeah.
People started being a little more careful about their trips. We've also found when you give people alternatives, when you give them good transit, when you put sidewalks in so they can walk and bike, they'll take advantage of it.
So there's lessons to be learned from both countries, I think.
I think so, yeah.
Polly Trottenberg, thanks very much for joining
us. Thanks, Helen. Thank you very much.
And that's Polly Trottenberg, the U.S. Assistant Secretary of Transport.